President is not here. We are waiting for our president to join.
I am sending message to him.
I think there is some problem with the connection. I just called him, so he said that he is not able to join. I think Dr. Saha can start with his keynote address, if we all agree. So Dr. Saha, please, I request you. Thank you for joining us today and for sparing time from your busy schedule. So please, sir, I would request that you please give your keynote address.
Oh, Gitanjali, thank you so much. I am audible to all. Am I audible,
sir,
to
you
all?
You are perfectly audible, yes. Please.
Okay, thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. Associate with three people, the young group, young people. And this is rare, always. It is really a fortunate enough to talk to you people, very dynamic personalities of this country, really. Gitanjali, hats off to you and all your entire team member, though have selected or elected or chosen me for to give in the keynote address. And first of all, greetings to all participants, probably around 37 participants I can also see here on the Harela. Greetings for all. Greetings for prosperity and success of our Mother Earth. If the mother survives, the children will automatically survive. So let's pay attention to our Mother Earth for its hariyali, let it be green. Coming to India, India is very fortunate. It's a very land of variety. We are having only 2.5% of the land. Just imagine, only 2.5%. of the land, but we are having 90% of the biodiversity of the world. Just fortunate to see, we are just sitting with the biodiversity. No proof is much better than India. No proof is much better than India. So the we must think, until and unless we feel proud of that thing, that we are really sitting, we are gifted by the God and the mother, our Mother is so affectionate with his, all his prosperity. So we cannot think of this. Coming to the biodiversity, once we are talking about the today, if we are going for, so biodiversity is a divine gift. If you are connecting with Harela, then it comes again to the diversity, the divine gift. That is very much important. And when there is divinity, there is spirituality, there is power, potential, attraction, affection, everything is there. And coming to biodiversity, it is a biological diversity. Actually, it is a biologically diversity. So genetic diversity, system diversity, habitat diversity, the species diversity, the distribution of land diversity, everything is connected with it. So once your diversity is there with you, that means you have to consider it is a biological resource diversity. So it's our resource. It's we are part of the reverse system, the biodiversity. And we are linked together. We are not alone. We are not. Human beings are not standing alone. But they are part of the diversity. Even in the human being, you will find that a lot of diversity is there. The northern people are different, the southern people are different, the western people are different, Himalayan people are different. So the variety will be there. The more the variety, more the genetic combination, more the revolution, and more the intelligent people will come to this earth. So that is very much important. And even if it is that we are a part of the things with that, and it is our fundamental duties. It is our fundamental duties to protect this diversity, to have compassion on them. That is important. We should be faithful. Nowadays, the compassion, we should be faithful. What the nature is asking? What is the demand of our nature? At least after COVID-19, this is a lesson we have learned. What is the demand of the nature? Are really our resources are at comfortable position? Are they really able to manage the load of great load of human being? It's not really. And it is, if you compare the load of human activities, we need 1.6 times of the earth. That means one earth is not adequate. So it is overloaded. Our earth is overloaded. And we need, as on date, it is estimated that we need 1.6 times of the earth. So, but we don't have any space. We don't have second earth where we can go and live with prosperity. So that is that the importance comes. Each and every activity is a burden for us. Burden for the nature, burden for the earth. So how to correlate and how to match with the carrying capacity of the nature, that is important. So that's why we should keep on focusing about what we have and how you can manage or rather improve the carrying capacity of the earth. And these only can be managed with the help of biodiversity. And local biodiversity, because the local is just most important. Again, the COVID-19 has taught that it is a local to local. Let's not go around. You have to develop our local system. The constant system at the local level, the land, the water, the plant, the everything as a local level we have to manage. So that is the thing. Whatever is possible, whoever is sitting at any corner of India, let him go with a local type of plantation, which is foolproof. Nature has done it after long experiment with it. Let's not move around that I have to have this particular type of extreme or I have to bring Y type of animal. No. What the nature can adapt, that we should go for it, because we have to revitalize our Mother Earth. That is the important part I would like to tell for us as on date. Now the thing is that what we have launched, whatever we eat, why we are so linked? We are linkages with the air, we are linkages with the medicine, our linkages with the water, our linkages with the food, our civilization is linked with the environmental components. We cannot really separate them. We can't. We are so much linked with the environment. We are so much linked with the environmental resources. We cannot really think of ourselves that we are alone and nobody is there to protect us. Nature is there to protect us. It's always helping us. Everything, whatever we require, it is supporting us. And that is part we need to recognize, acknowledge, and appreciate. And let's develop affection for the nature. Just think of a tree. Nobody is giving food to it. It is a self-producing, produces its own food. But how many types of it? It's a complete ecosystem. One plant is connecting all three ecosystems. The water, the land, the air. All three ecosystems is connected, and it is the fourth one is the groundwater is connected, given shelter to the many birds and many other any other biodiversity, offering food, shade, and our woods also. So such a thing, and compared to a tree, just to compare in human being, human being is only in the consumer. We only consume, we don't give anything, we don't have any linkage. We take everything, but in return we don't even, we are not giving. That giving part, because we don't are not able to give to the nature. So we have to give, have importance for our environmental resources, so that we can compensate them something. So that's the urgency for us. And we must do it. And that's why all festivals, all our rituals, all are connected with the nature, the animals, and all is there. So we have to enhance the restorative process of the Mother Earth, and we have to reduce exploitation. And exploitation, we have to reduce at any cost, because restoration is the great loss for the environmental resources. If it is being used for the purpose, it is okay. But we have to remember the resources are constant. And resources, that's why we have to improve the resources. And the resources are cycling, moving in a cycling order. So everything is connected. Everything is connected. So that's why I would like to tell the Himalayan biodiversity, 4 global biodiversity hotspots are there. Entire northeast to north enter, it is connected, and the largest resources in the world, it is a source of 10 major river systems, and and it is facing the diverse culture, language, religion, and traditional knowledge. Why I'm talking about the traditional knowledge? Each and every traditional knowledge has scientific evidences. What is can be proved, it can be linked with the environment. Please do, let's do attention for this local thing. As I told, local thing. Local traditional knowledge is very important for us. And Himalayas is the 333 important world biodiversity is there. It is world don't know even how much it is we are having. So let us pay attention to it. Let's pay attention to our Mother Earth. Pay attention to our biodiversity. Let's see if well. Keep well, and thank you very much for organizing such a beautiful on this evening. And it is a very long story that we can go, but today I would like to hear from the other people also. So let's hope for the best, and let's consider biodiversity is a divine resource for us. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Saha. And now I would request our president. President IIT Delhi Alumni Association, Mr. Ravindra Kumar, to share his views. Sir, please.
You have to unmute.
One minute. I'm audible?
Yeah, you are audible now, sir. Yes.
I'm very sorry that I'm a bit late, because technically I was experimenting something new. So, but anyway, my team, Dr. Gitanjali Kaushik and Jochna, I think, I don't know whether Mr. Ashok has joined or still.
So we are all here.
Okay, okay.
So we were waiting for you, actually.
Yeah. So Satosh, Ashok is just 1 year senior to me. So it's good that everybody is here. And I'm very sorry that I'm a bit late. Yeah. So already Dr. Shah has given a lot of thoughts, and since I have joined, so Gitanjali, I think you are done the welcome part and everything.
Sir, we would like to hear your thoughts. Yeah, the welcome part is over, but your thoughts are remaining still. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. See, thank you, Dalsi. I am basically not a subject expert, not a technical expert as far as this topic goes. So, anyway, since you are asking me, so I'll just give what I feel about the tree in the forest. And with this, I'm taking the liberty that I'm breaking the flow of your webinar, because already technical speakers have come and they have, Dr. Shah has given, he has talked in various dimensions about the overall environment and stakeholders who are there with the environment. So with that, good afternoon to all. And as Gitanjali has introduced, I'm the Ravindra Kumar, president of IIT Delhi, and I welcome all the distinguished speakers on the for this webinar. Dr. Shah has already spoken, already given his thoughts, and as for I think now Mr. Dr. Muthiya will focus on faunal diversity, and Dr. Kumar from BAU Ranchi will present site on floral diversity. And I welcome all the participants, experts, ITD alumni, scientists, and students to this webinar. And just before giving again back to the Gitanjali, because Gitanjali is a session moderator, I just would like to share some of my personal thoughts. That as I see individual, when we grow up our in life, and since with the childhood, we see the tree. We in our Indian ethos and culture, the tree plays a very big role in our cultural settings. So I was just before this the seminar was there. I was just discussing with the Gitanjali that yes, when I was a child, there was a small peepal tree grown up in my village, in my courtyard, and I just nurtured the plant, and then when plant attained, got some height, and I used to stay with my grandparents. They told that peepal tree is not auspicious in the house, so it should be planted, it's uprooted and should be planted maybe in the forest or some far away from the place. So then that small peepal tree, the plant was taken out in the near one pond, and I, to my surprise, when I was in eighth standard in 1978, I got a news that the peepal tree has to marry. It has to be married because it's become now become an adult. So it was a very it's a different kind of experience for me. The peepal is marrying to some another tree. I don't know the biological name of the tree, but we called Kejri in the Rajasthan. It's a very abundantly found. It's also considered as a, like equivalent to Tulsi. So it's a, considered as a, a dev. So people and that both, because dev, the god has to marry another god. So, but once I grown up, then I came to know that these have, 1 minute. My, So when I grown up, I came to know that this is the culturally they are regarded as gold, but otherwise they played a role in lot of good role they play in the environment. They have economic value, and so this is the as far as my childhood association with the tree and the importance and the how the Indian culture the people is considered devta and all the stuff is there, and the tree plays a lot of role. And I mean, few years back, even the before Abhishek Bachchan got married with the Aishwarya Rai, I think he also Aishwarya Rai also married 2-3 trees. I don't know what are the trees, but there's a tree. Even they act as a protector as far as our Indian cultural system is concerned. They play a different kind of role. The tree not only they feed us, they give a lot of flora, fauna, oxygen, or take care of a lot of greenhouse emission or soil erosion and a lot of other activities I think the experts will take. But I think the tree protection of tree and all things are in deep rooted in our cultural system, in our day-to-day life. So this festival, the Harala festival of the Uttarakhand Pradesh, today the Chief Honorable Chief Minister also has appealed that each citizen should plant at least one tree. And I also knows the view of the Chief Minister that we should plant at least one tree or protect the existing tree. Without knowing this footprint, the carbon footprint or carbon load, when I was young, when people used to talk that there is a lot of pollution of the motor vehicle, I used to tell when we buy one motor vehicle, we should adopt one tree also, we should plant one tree also. So that suppose when the petrol version is given 15 years of a license, we should have one tree which at least give 15 years the oxygen to the environment. So I read in some newspaper also in Rajasthan that in the marriage people were giving the plants when the marriage party, when they exchange the greetings. So that is a good sign. A lot of awareness is there, and this is a good initiative taken by my team, especially Dr. Gitanjali Kaushik. And before ending my views, I would say that even the trees, they played role in what human being as we are. Around 6.5 million years ago, when we are just near to our distant cousin chimpanzees, genetically we are only 1.23% different from the chimpanzee. But what the difference has been made, that those chimpanzee or the distant cousin who were part of the drier part of the Africa, drier part. So those who are living the dense forest, they used to get the fruits and other things very easily. But those are in the drier part, they have to stand up and struggle to get the fruits. So that made the homo sapiens become biped, and then freed our hands.
And that gave the tools, and that just made us what we are today. So the forest and at what height they are bringing the fruits had played a big role in what we are. Thank you all the experts and attendees who have come to join.
Now I'll give to my colleague, Dr. Gitanjali Kaushik, to take this webinar to its real flow, more on the technical side and the subject experts. And I'm again very sorry that I was in between, I just jumped in.
But I hope that you will enjoy the rest of the webinar. And over to Dr. Gitanjali Kaushik. Thank you
so much, sir, for very, very motivating words. And you spoke with a lot of conviction and experience. Thank you so much for joining us. And now I would request Dr. Muthaiya Murugunandan to join us for his speech. And Dr. Murugunandan is a Fulbright scholar working as principal scientist in the Hydrology and Engineering Division at the ICAR, Indian Institute of Soil and Water Conservation, Dehradun. He acquired his postdoctoral research experience from South Dakota State University, US. He is the founder scientist in charge of fisheries science at IISWC, who established fisheries science research facilities at the institute. And he has over 25 years of research and professional experience in multidisciplinary research and diverse topics. He has 30 professional recognitions, including 3 national fellowships, Fulbright Award. And I request Dr. Murugunandan to give his special address. Once again, a very warm welcome, Dr. Muthaiya. Please. Good afternoon, Dr. Muthaiah. Can you hear us?
Yeah.
Okay, great. Nice to see you.
Yeah.
Can we have your video, please?
Yeah, I think it must be all right.
We still can't see you, actually.
Okay, I don't know. Yeah, we are 48 on board. All right.
Yeah.
So, thank you, Dr. Ketanjali and her team for organizing one of the important webinar and in this lockdown period as well, and commemorate the importance of the Green Festival. Should I share my slide?
Yes, please share your Please share your slides. Yeah.
You can allow me to share because it has a hold. Yeah, it shows post disabled participants screen sharing.
Satish ji, can you please help Dr. Muthaiah?
Yeah, and
hello.
Yeah.
Yes, in today. Hello.
Yeah,
please allow him to share his slides.
Okay
share screen.
Yeah just a minute.
Good morning, ma'am. Got familiar?
Yes, I think now you can share.
Yeah. Now
yes,
please. Share. Yeah. So I'm audible and visible.
I still can't.
Okay.
I think you should start your presentation now.
Right. I'll run. Okay. You have given me half an hour time, 15 minutes time. Okay. Now let us discuss and share some of the views and ideas on Himalayan biodiversity. And because I particularly personally take it seriously and get into pond and dive into the topic and dwell, so that we gain some knowledge out of that. So I have prepared a few slides and we can discuss and share. Yeah.
Yes.
So as we talk and discuss about biodiversity, we must know how many of them we are dealing with. And biodiversity, everybody knows that it's a diversity and biological matter, bioresource, all that one on which we sustain and we make our life, and the world is also revolving around that. So not to talk of on that. And we have got something around 1.7 million species in the world, which is very meager, and which is something 5 to 10% of the world biota, and still 5 to 10%, 30 million are remain to be explored. That is where these biologists' role and taxonomists' role is coming into picture. And these many species over the centuries or 200 centuries, they have identified only 1.78, and lot many is remaining to be identified. Hello, I'm audible, sir.
Yeah, you are audible. Yeah.
Okay. All right. And in India, we have got something around 45,000 species and 30,000 flowering plants. And in Himalayas, we use around 3,000 medicinal plants, and of which 1,700 are Indian Himalayan species available. And our India supports 5% of the world biodiversity on its 2% of landmass. So there is a pressure. We are rich, and the very same richness also causes problems, that we are not able to manage our rich resources, and we get into complacency, and we don't manage our resources. Degrade. So why do we ponder on biodiversity conservation? Because on which only the earth revolves and we are making our life. And 40% of medicines are coming from these plants and animals, and from 95% of the known plant species. And that means 40% of modern medicines come from only 5% of the plant known. And not many 90% of plants are to be explored for various benefits, including medicinal values. And 100 species supply 90% of our world food. Rather, it is not even 100%. The whole world is revolving around 20 species only. So though we have got a variety of species and we are dwelling on every about 110 to 20 species for our food production and livelihood security. The whole world also loses 42 million area of tropical forest due to various factors. And at this rate of destruction and loss, we will be losing entire our forest resources in coming years. And as we all know that this is, all right, should I go continue?
Please continue.
Okay. So, here is a map that this map shows that biodiversity at country level. So India is one of the bioresource rich country, one of the 17 mega diverse country. So it is rich. This deep color indicates richness of the biodiversity, and the very same richness is a big problem for our management, in the sense we are not serious to manage our resource and harness benefit out of that. And here is a statistic that for the species and their composition in our at country level. In country level, and we have got flowering plants and freshwater fish and amphibians and mammals. They are all, and within those our country, it has got about 4 biodiversity hotspots, hotspots across the world. So Himalayas, Indo-Burma, and Western Ghats, and Sundal and Nicobar Islands, they form the biodiversity hotspots. It has got its own definition, and that we'll see later. And this slide also highlights the importance and diversity, importance of our Indian biodiversity in all agriculture and forest and natural resource sectors.
Right, sir.
And Himalayas, if you talk about Himalayas is a very unique landscape. And it has got diverse ecosystems and habitats and diverse bioresources, and as well as it is a fragile landmass because of young mountain, and it has got frequent landslides and land degradation and higher soil erosion and dependent problems that affects biodiversity and bioresources. And how is important aquatic species and terrestrial biodiversity like caterpillar fungus, which is these days it is harvested from the high mountains by the local people in parts of Himalayas, particularly Uttarakhand or Darchula area of Uttarakhand. And timru is also one of the medicinal plants. It's extensively harvested for many purposes. And it also provides hydroelectric power support facilities and hydro energy for water mills. And water mill based hydro energy water mills are processing of agriculture food. These are done by these water mills, and it provides livelihoods for millions of people, and it is a source of recreation and tourism also. And if you compare Himalayan countries, Hindu-Kush Himalayan countries, India is rich in various resources like angiosperm, gymnosperm, mammals and birds. And majority are higher groups, they have been documented and identified, and lower groups are still undocumented and unidentified because of difficult terrain and lack of interest and lack of taxonomies and lack of provisions for studying the lower groups. And Himalayan ecosystem, it's the central Himalaya is rich in terms of species, and followed by Western Himalayas and Northwest Himalayas and Eastern Himalayas and Ladakh regions in terms of biodiversity. And this slide also highlights in the same that of India, Indian Himalayan region harbors rich biodiversity, yet this habitat and climate change and other anthropogenic pressures question all these our resources. Here is a slide that recent SFR, forest state of forest report 2019, done by this FSI, Forest Survey of India. Every couple of years, alternatively, they bring out this SFR, state of forest resources, state of forest report 2019. It shows that
hello, ha sir, yes sir,
yeah,
yes sir,
our resources are
five webinar chal raha sir, yes sir,
our forest resources are well within our projected target. This national forest policy has targeted to have a forest cover and tree cover of 33% plains and about 66 to 67% in hills and mountains like Himalayas. So if you see 2019, it is only 25% of total geographic area. And this target was fixed by in 1952, way back in 1952, when the first forest policy came into existence. So since then, we are not able to meet the target. And this target is fixed just for just to have the possible ecosystem services and livelihood.
Hello,
and
hi sir.
Livelihood options. And now even the latest SFR also suggests that we have not met the target and we are way behind with the 24% of the total geographic area. And if you account only forest, it will be 21%. And again, this includes the total geography, including mountains and Himalayas. If you take out the Himalayas and mountains, it would be much lesser. It would be much lesser than this also, and giving you a gap of lower forest cover. So all that indicate that our bioresource and forest cover and forestry dependent ecosystems are not at a comfortable state, because forest cover and tree cover are a kind of a proxy for understanding the health of ecosystems and dependent riverine ecosystems and terrestrial ecosystems. If forests are rich and healthy and in an extensive area, it indicates the area and resources and habitats are rich enough to support population and biodiversity and other population, local people, and it would again support our economy and climate and environment as well. So these reports shows that we are not comfortable in terms of forest cover and greenery, and that is how these kind of festivals and Harela and greening the programs would come into picture, and we must continue the effort, and rightly we are doing so. And as compared to northern eastern Himalayas and western Himalayas, eastern Himalayan forest cover is comparatively better off, 79%, 80%, 60% like that. And the western Himalayans, Himachal Pradesh, Jammu and Uttarakhand, they are something around 45% and even 10%, 25%. Here it should have been 67%. So overall, this forest cover is cover and dependent biodiversity is not that comfortable in a good position so far. And similarly, this year onwards, this SFR has contained biodiversity also, kind of forest diversity. So far they have been compiling forest extent of forest cover, tree cover, all that. And this year onwards, they have brought what are the species and grouping of species like trees, shrubs and herbs in the SFR. And here also a number of species, here they have got something around Himachal 324, Jammu Kashmir 478, Uttarakhand 279, total number of trees and shrubs that they have identified through different indices and indicators while making their report and surveys. And this was forest-related resources, forest cover. And similarly, we have got in Indian Himalayas has got rich agrobiodiverse resources also. So this table shows that our different agricultural products, agricultural commodities, and different wild and cultivated varieties or variants of these species. So here, these are all traditional varieties of the farmed ones. Our NBPG or one National Bureau of Plant Genetic Resources, they have been studying or compiling these wild counterparts of the farmed or domesticated crops. So this indicates that we have got rich biodiversity, but still we are still depending on only 4 to 5 crops for our major staple food, like paddy, wheat, and maize. These three, four crops form the bulk of 50% of our farmed crops, despite we having got rich resources. These are some of the rice varieties our country institutes have documented and recorded. Maize and rice and these beans. And similarly, these crops also have different ecosystem, different environments, intercropping. And this is intercropping with agroforestry with trees and fodder crops, intercropping. And these bees diversity is one of the important diversity which helps in agricultural production and through pollination. Because there is a study that it says there is a need for 500 million bees colonies, and now we have got only 120 bee colonies, 120 million colonies, which all have vanished because of our anthropogenic activities and climate change and various developmental activities. So these pollinators and bees need to be promoted in coming days. These days, even the farmers buy bee colonies per colony 100 rupees, 200 rupees, like that. They buy bee colonies from vendors and install in their fields to get pollinated. Their crops get pollinated for to increase, so that increased production is materialized. And with these rich biodiversity, we get rich landscapes and aesthetic and tourism and recreational facility as well. These are all sort of ecosystem service other than food and value, tangible, non-intangible benefits emanating out of ecosystem services. And these are some of these farm animals with which our economy revolves. Cattle and goat, sheep and rabbit and cold water fish and pigs, poultry are different diverse resources on which our agriculture production and livestock production depends on. And as regard to fish, we have got rich number of cold water species in the country. Cold water species means the species which are in cold water region, mainly in Himalayans and western Ghat hills. And we have got number of species and some of the exotic species as well. But their contribution to national fisheries production is very minimum. And before getting possible harvest and economic benefits from these species, we are threatening them because many species has got into endangered status or vulnerable status by these IUCN or conservationists. So these needs to be accounted while exploiting our resources, and because they are particularly fish and all, we may not know. They are underwater. What is happening underwater, we will not know, because if anything happens in the terrestrial or upland ecosystem, we are in the open area, we can know, we can witness our developments. But in underwater, we will not know what is happening also, how many species are there, what is the dynamics, all that. So unknowingly or deliberately, they are being destroyed over years, and their number and their population abundance and diversity is also getting reduced over years, which is visibly seen from the catch statistics from different streams and stretches. These are some of the dominant local or indigenous species from these Uttarakhand Himalayas, Sisothorax. This is a major staple fish, and this is a very demanded fish, Master Sambal, as locally known as Gooch. And this is Tor. This is a tiger of the fish, tiger of the water, because it is having a good maneuvering, and it has been used in sports fishing, all that. And these are some of these minor local species. They contribute to ecosystem services and support our ecosystems and contribute to the fish production. And these three, six species are widely cultivated across the country, even in the Himalayas also. These first three are Indian major carps widely farmed, and these last three are Chinese carps. They are brought from China. All these six species are called major carps, Indian major carps and exotic major carps. And they are being farmed together in farm ecosystem, pond ecosystem, in artificial ecosystems to enhance fish production. And this is a trout brought from England by these our colonial people during 100 years back for their own benefit and of sports and food supply. And this is Mashi, that this is a tiger of the water, and it's traditionally known for sports fishing, and it is having a good food and nutritional value. And this is a Gladius garipine, Thai magur. It was brought from Thailand and it's an exotic species, but it is nationally banned considering the ecosystem health and welfare, because it is a voracious carnivorous fish and it would destroy the ecosystem and other components. And these are some of these cold water species which you have seen, this trout and snow trout. It is Indian trout, indigenous species. This is exotic species. And this is rainbow trout, and Mashi, this is tiger of the water. Earlier it used to be in big size and in abundance, but these days it is reducing in many places. It has been termed endangered, but it is not that endangered. It is widely available, but their size and abundance is drastically getting reduced over years and in different spatio-temporal scales. And here, these are all major streams in Uttarakhand. And this Bhagirathi and Felangana, it's a snow-fed river where this dairy dam has been established. Earlier, it used to be snow trout dependent streams. Now they have changed to different population after this dam construction. And these are some of these list of different species in Uttarakhand. And these are different, this is exotic species, bungas and tilapia. And this also widely formed in our country, including in the Himalayan region, because they are fast growing and it is giving better return to the farmers. So farmers are interested in farming these two species. And having seen this biodiversity of plants, animals, forests, all that, and we now understand that they contribute to ecosystem services in terms of provisioning food, fiber, all that, supporting cultural and regulating, and which all come from different agro ecosystems, because this biodiversity and biological resource is a base in different ecosystems, because it can be viewed as stocks and from which this environmental flows as a function and as a service. So these biodiversity could be a stock, and from which environmental ecosystem services would flow, which would support our living. Yeah, this is the same concept, that how this biodiversity supports our food production and livelihood and ecosystem services. So these are some of these goods and services we realize from ecosystems or from biodiversity, kind of recreational and food and even medicinal, traditional medicinal. This man removes the paste from a paste of pine. He has pasted for dressing his wound. And this traditionally distilled liquor, all that part of all that is the basics from biodiversity as ecosystem service only. And here is traditional fishing festivals are organized in this part of Himalayas. So this timru powder is timru is a traditionally or indigenous shrub which grows to 5-6 meters. It's a small shrub and which can be which is powdered and applied in the river, and 7 kilometers down below the stretch, all the aquatic organisms including fish becomes unconscious, becoming easy to catch. It's a kind of cultural event that's also coming from this biodiversity, or one of the biodiversity resource, and fish, and it's a food pack, and this is material used for distilling traditional drinks made out of 17-18 herbs. And these are all some of the scenic beauties and recreational and aesthetic values coming out of these biodiversity and ecosystem services. Yeah, and these are all. And again, now we having seen the resources and ecosystem services, and we have got nationally disturbing challenges due to population growth, urbanization, food insecurity, malnutrition, and dam construction, river mining, environmental pollution, and altered water quality. There are a number of challenges mainly driven by the population, industrialization, and commercialization of our products and commodities. And here is urbanization pressure and religious pollution and point source pollution and non-point source of runoff and indiscriminate fishing using bleaching and dynamites and bombs and construction of dams, blocking the water flow, all that. All that is form as challenges, national challenges for managing our resources, particularly in delicate Himalayan region. And here I have listed number of anthropogenic activities that would affect our biodiversity and natural resources, which would require our intervention and management, including these introduction of exotics like Thai Magore, Juliflora, Epipotorium, Acacia, Lantana, Parthenium. They are all exotic weed species. They have been introduced for different purpose. Now they have become a weed and destroying our ecosystem and habitats, both in terrestrial and aquatic ecosystems. And ritual pollutions, all that. And that would affect frequent landslides, soil loss, land degradation, and loss of species, wildlife, habitats, ecosystem, and agricultural and fisheries, livestock production and yield, all that happening. And these are some of the slides that what is happening around that questions our biodiversity and natural resources, which is which are requiring our attention, and road construction, blockage of the drainage, and damaged fish pond damming, and riverbed material extraction. And because they are removing the riverbed and sandstone, they are all important components of aquatic ecosystem. They support food production and they form the habitats for different aquatic species, including fish, on which our economy depends. And damaged poultry herd, these are all different damages, landslide, roadslides, roadside landslides, riverside, all that happening because of loss in the biodiversity. And because once this forest cover, land cover is disturbed, and that would disturb the question of the stability of the land mass and induces landslides. And here, influence of these dams and interlinking of rivers. Now we have been talking quite a few years, and these dams are hydraulic and hydrologic structures like dams and weirs disturb the regulate or modify the riverine flow, and that causes the ecosystem fragmentation and altering the species functional composition and community structure and nutrient and sediment inflow to the rivers and downstream, and including the coastal environment and timing and duration of flooding and riparian zones. They are all altered. They are all necessary rather for different fish species for their breeding and growth. And similarly, this ILR also would alter natural distribution and timing of stream flow, and it would homogenize the biodiversity in different parts of the streams, different streams. So that is not a good sign, but we need, while in the name of development, if we propose, then we must understand the repercussion, then accordingly we must take an informed decision. And there are some statistics in many other countries, the dams are being decommissioned for these influences. But of course, particularly if you see this Terry Dam, it's ecologically it may be compromising, but economically and for national development, it is contributing immensely. And it is one of the profit-making proposition and system, and it is generating a lot of energy and electricity and irrigation facility, and it supports huge development. Also, it impounds a huge amount of water bodies on which we can program our fisheries and our recreational activities. So though they might ecologically disturb and it might benefit our other developmental avenues, so we need to have a compromise and kind of balancing effect. We must understand what is the impact and how we can improve and we can lessen the impact. So here in after the dam, this marshy population has become imbalanced, because in that Terry Dam, less of females and more of male is been landing, because and that would disturb the natural breeding. And similarly, earlier used to be snow trout and marshy dominant catch there. But after the dam commissioned, these marshy and common carp only dominating the catches. So we need to understand what was earlier and what is happening now, so that what sort of correction we can put into place, so that our destruction and damage becomes minimum, and we compromise our development while safeguarding our resources. And here is a slide that economic growth also would affect our biodiversity. So while planning for economic development, we need to understand the impact on biodiversity and how best we can nullify the impact on biodiversity or reduce the impact on biodiversity. And if you don't do that, then these 17 of the 17 mega diverse country announced by this Conservation International would lead to risky country. Now we are stated as a biodiversity rich country, and now soon we would be leading to biodiversity poor country. And because of WWF already has indicated that India is in a very high risk status in terms of threat to biodiversity. So having understood all these things, we need to understand our ecosystems and their food chain, food web, so that our developmental activities and our harvesting regime all understands and works within the principles of ecosystem and biodiversity conservation. So that we maintain biological integrity and that supports sustainable harvesting and natural resource management.
Dr. Muthaiya, I think you will have to start a bit and conclude.
Yeah. Now we have got number of laws and policies and action plans to safeguard our resources, but still they are at the minimum level. Even this Supreme Court and High Court has given the rivers Ganga, Yamuna as a living status. So they need to be parented. Parenting support should be given, and Niti Aayog has given a proposition for Himalayan Authority to have a converged effort from different departments and different authorities and different stakeholders, so that our Himalayan resources are managed better. And that's all. And we have got some challenges, and I have listed some of the way forwards, and that we will manage better. And that's all. And I am a party to this Biodiversity Board Uttarakhand as an expert member for managing this riverine biodiversity in Uttarakhand. And we have been surveying all that. And the point is that we need to understand ecosystem and biodiversity for our own living. That's all. And our institute is working on different initiatives of soil and water conservation, watershed management, and biodiversity conservation. And we have been sensitizing stakeholders through different means of media and sensitization workshops and seminar like this. And that's all. I'll end up here. And last year, we had a kind of workshop or a seminar on understanding the local and knowledge of biodiversity and how best we can help them to conserve our resources. That's all. Thank you.
Dr. Muthaiya, thank you so much for a very, very comprehensive presentation. You started with Himalayas, the flora, the fauna, then the challenges that we are facing, then coming on to initiatives. And since I am associated with you, so I know how much you have worked at the grassroots level, sensitizing the villagers, especially for the fishing festivals. So thank you so much. And after we get over Dr. Kumar's presentation, we'll come back to you. Thank you so much.
Right. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. So now I am very pleased to welcome Dr. Kaushal Kumar from Birsa Agricultural University. Dr. Kumar is a first class graduate and a postgraduate in botany from Bhagalpur University. He has his PhD on ethnomedicinal plants from Institute of Medical Sciences, Banaras Hindu University in 1997. He has been awarded various research associateships by DST. Then he joined NBRI Lucknow, National Botanical Research Institute, on the post of Scientist B, then Scientist C. He was also with Patanjali Yogpeeth Haridwar as a senior scientist from 2007 to 2009. Currently, he is subject matter specialist and head department of forest products, faculty of forestry, Birsa Agricultural University. He has more than 70 research papers in national and international journals, 3 books, and delivered more than 60 lectures. He is the nodal officer of BAU Ranchi for vocational courses of UGC. And he has been principal investigator of several research and extension projects of Government of India. He has widely explored medicinal plants through field survey in the Himalayan region, Andaman and Nicobar Islands, Indo-Gangetic Plains, Chota Nagpur Plateau, and the Indian Desert. And he also very recently has been given a project on Giloy. So thank you so much, Dr. Kumar, for joining us. And once again, a warm welcome to you and all the participants. So I would request you now to start with your presentation.
Thank you, madam. Good afternoon.
Satish ji, can you share the screen for Dr. Kumar, his presentation? I think in the meantime, you can start talking, Dr. Kumar.
Yeah, good evening to all of you. Thank you to Dr. Gitanjali Kaur, madam. Everybody is so slow.
Yeah, it's very difficult.
So I want to know everybody can. It is difficult to connect. मेरी आवाज नहीं पड़ रही है मेरी आवाज सुनाई पड़ रही है
हाँ आप इफ यू हैव इफ यू कैन
आवाज सुनाई
कैन यू शेयर स्क्रीन डॉक्टर कुमार हेलो
हाँ नेटवर्क स्लो है आप स्क्रीन चलाएं
एक्चुअली स्क्रीन शेयर नहीं कर पा रहे हैं सतीश जी इज नॉट एबल टू शेयर आप शेयर कर सकते हैं क्या Satish ji, are you able to share the screen? Dr. Kumar, you have disabled the presentation, so इसीलिए association share नहीं कर पा रहा
है. Actually, the host disabled participant screen sharing.
Okay, so. Okay.
अगर नहीं screen हो पा रही share हो पा रही है, but I want to say that. Monia is the store house of the medicinal plant, and since ancient wisdom, there is only one place in the world which are renowned for the medicinal plant, and my topic is the medicinal plant.
I'm trying to share, but we. How do we go about it now?
Potential medicinal plant. Now, I may say that there are some very good medicinal plants like the Ati Saponatum Heterophylla, and it is the antibiotic that has contains the root, and it is a very important plant. Second is the Daru Hydra.
It's not audible. Dr. Murugunandan, are you still here with us?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we can go back to your presentation because it's not audible to anyone, right? He wanted to share some work on his Giloy, but I think it's not possible.
Why? So, he can do. I think we just help him, support him.
We actually, his connection in Ranchi is really poor. It's not possible actually to hear.
Actually, he can switch off his he can put off his video and only show the slides. Ask him to switch off the videos and share the slide alone.
Dr. Kumar, आप वीडियो ऑफ करके सिर्फ ऑडियो से शेयर कर ऑडियो शेयर करेंगे
ऑडियो फेस करेंगे ऑडियो बोलेंगे
हाँ ऑडियो खोलिए सिर्फ
to stop your video, share the slide and speak, unmute mic and start speaking, yeah, then it should be all right.
Nahin, it's not audible, nahin ho raha hai Dr. Kumar. I think Dr. Muruganandan, you can go to your last slides where you have shared the way forward, and after that we can take up the Q&A.
Okay.
Because we have only 15 minutes, right? So I think 7 minutes you can summarize and then we can take up the questions.
Let us do that.
Yeah, please go to your summary section where you had listed the way forward. We can discuss that and take up the questions.
Yeah. I just closed the PowerPoint. I'm just coming back. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Please do that.
But yes. Come prepared with some slides and information. I thought then we can listen.
Yeah.
Oh, it's not working. Yeah.
Yeah. Sometimes it's all technology. It's a lot of rains there in Ranchi. It's really poor. Really poor.
Mr. Kumar can mail the presentation to Mr. Uthaya. Then he can make the presentation on his behalf.
Sir, we are trying to open his presentation. Even that presentation is not opening. Is your presentation opening, Dr. Muthaya?
Yeah, mine is ready.
Okay, please start. Start with the way forward.
Yeah. Let me go to way forward.
Yeah.
We have got limited challenges, but we have got much way forward.
Yes, yeah. Please. Yeah. Share the screen.
Yeah.
I think by 4:20 you can do that, and then in the last 10 minutes we can take up the question answers.
Yeah. So this is that we need to have a first view to understand the way forward. We must know the challenges as well, Anna.
Yes, please go ahead. I think challenges are clear. You please come to the way forward. Yeah. Yeah, please.
And this rich, we have got rich biodiversity. At times, that richness also causes a problem. As I told, because a rich man always feels that I am comfortable and I am immune to disturbances and damages. So that brings a complacence and poor management. And hilly is a rugged and hilly, rugged terrain and remote area. People don't go for surveys and identification. That is where our much of the biodiverse resources are not being categorized and documented yet, particularly in lower groups, lower taxonomic groups. and prevalence of size and value, because the bigger the size and better would be the economic and taxonomic interest. So larger groups and bigger groups, advanced taxonomic groups have been identified and documented well relatively, and lower groups are not been documented, in particularly in Himalayas, because of this terrain and all that. Because in Western this what you call Western Ghats and all, people have studied all the groups and well documented because of their elevations and comfort of reaching and easy studies, which is a little difficult in Himalayan perspectives. And of course, climate change, upward movement of tree lines, and altered biodiversity composition and population dynamics, recruitment and production patterns also challenging. Yeah, in Himalayas, predominance of migrant populations. The Himalayan populations are migrating in nature, and poor coordination synergy between different organizations like BSI, ZSI, FSI. This FSI is Forest Survey of India. This is Fishery Survey of India. G.P. Pant Institute of Himalayan Environment, Wildlife Institute, and ICRC. We have got many different institutes in Himalayas, and they all have different mandated works, and they largely they work different BSI and ZSI. They are focusing on taxonomic identification, and forest survey, of course, they are identifying the forest cover and these days forest biodiversity as well. But fishery survey, they are focusing on mainly marine surveys, and as such, these rivers and riverine biodiversity has become nobody's business, so nobody's baby, and we are left to academia and research scholars and students who are stationed in these Himalayan streams to study and document. So whatever we have got, it's mainly these academia and professors and students and scholars, those who have studied over years. So that is the knowledge we have got, and we really have limited coordination and energy between departments and stakeholders, and ignoring the capacity of local people and access and benefit sharing systems. And increasing interface between wildlife and biodiversity. Wildlife is a menace for agriculture production and biodiversity. So how do we manage that? And then how do we resolve the associated conflicts? And no limited historical data. We don't have historical data because since the colonial era, we don't have much population dynamics and quantification of different bioresources. People have identified and documented in terms of economic description, but we don't have population dynamics and what was earlier and in how much quantity and what was the dynamics in location. We don't have a historical data with which we can compare now also. So even now, we don't have any data on population dynamics for many species, including aquatic species and terrestrial species. We need to take up urgently, maybe through a dedicated manpower and financial outlay. And poor understanding, lack of adequate research and training facilities, of course, and poor understanding on the upstream and downstream and upland and lowland reaches also happening. And with and minimum environmental flows, what is the record environmental flows in most of the streams and rivers? Little thoughts and efforts have gone into bigger rivers. But in the Himalayan rivers, not much studies are there, and we need to take up that. The Himalayan rivers has become nobody's baby these days, and it is on its own. It's Bhagwan ka parsa mein jata hai na. Is taraf nobody bothers much on, particularly in biodiversity perspectives. And poor adoption of technology. These people around in the Himalayas have a tendency to adopt, maybe due to difficult terrain and hilly topography, and poor adoption of technologies, and poor conversion rate of biology or biodiversity into technology, poor quantification, commodification, or commercialization of available bioresources for entrepreneurs and economic exploitation, and resource degradation and deforestation, and emptying the rivers, literally empty the rivers through over exploitation and illegal and unscientific manner of harvesting, and way behind threshold limits of forest cover. Of course, we have seen that. And lack of policy-oriented research. These are some of the challenges which are mainly coming from these population pressure and dependent demands and articulations. And for which what we need to do is policy-oriented research, because of taking up random research, so what sort of policy we should be needing to manage our biodiversity and natural resources, so that our resources can be better managed, means policy can be communicated to these right agencies and stakeholders. So it becomes an order of the day for management of our resources. And for which we need to have adequate manpower. And manpower we cannot generate through experts alone. So we can recruit para experts like para veterinarians, para fish vets, and para taxonomies and self-help volunteer groups for identifying the bioresources and documenting them and disseminating them and putting into different purposes, uses. And inventorize and prioritize resources, problems, and technological solutions, and evolve conservation protocols and planning and execution. Conduct action research on biodiversity and its assessment and stock assessment, because we need to understand the population dynamics and the population status and distribution abundance of a given species and given in a given area that need to be studied and documented, so that that becomes a historical data for comparison in future situations and scenarios. And research on unexplored areas, upstream and downstream linkages and intricacies of research need, research and interactions and management needed and need to be evolved. So, and identify, prioritize stressed stretch. We need to identify stressed stretch and rivers and terrestrial ecosystems for prioritized management. We may not be able to manage the entire ecosystem and habitats in one go. So we can identify the damaged resources and areas and prioritize for their treatment through watershed management programs and NRM, natural resource management, bio-augmentation and bioengineering measures, or maybe through stocking and ranching of in different streams and improving the riverine habitats, all that. And we may need to quantify the nexus between the forest covers and aquatic ecosystems, and how do they supply nutrients and the sediments to the aquatic ecosystems, how far they are necessary for managing our riverine and aquatic ecosystem as well. And another thing, it could be this reforestation, afforestation, ranching and stocking of affected species in suitable stretches, so that their population gets improved and supports the biodiversity and economic benefits. And regulated and controlled felling of forests and harvesting of resources. So we need to develop adequate hatchery and nurseries to support these stocking and ranching program and afforestation programs. And saying is easier and doing when it comes to practice, and it is a lot of problems. So we must understand all the nitty-gritty things and what are the inputs we may be needing. So in that context, hatchery and nursery are one of the prime needs there to support our reforestation, afforestation and ranching programs. And we need to understand the ecosystem environmental flows, the minimum what is the minimum depth and spawning depth for different species in a given stretch, so that that is maintained and river health is protected. And promote research to convert biology and bioresources into technology. We need to take action research so that identify the bioresources for different benefits, and we must generate technologies out of many different bioresources. And promote responsible road and resource and connectivity development with adequate buffer zones and debris dumping zones, because these road construction and damaging the landscapes only the major source of destruction in river courses and aquatic ecosystems. And application of modern technology may be implemented or adopted in Himalayan resource management, particularly remote sensing and GIS, and to have an appropriate decision support system to understand our resources and exploitation and management. Need of systematic documents of traditional knowledge, as our previous speaker told, we need to document and understand traditional knowledge and resources and generate pharma products from plants and animals based on the bioethnology, ethnobiological studies and observations for alternate therapeutic and zootherapy and phytotherapy. And devise knowledge-driven policies and legal protection regime. So that our rivers and resources are protected better. And if the resources are, if biodiversity or some bioresources are damaged beyond our control, or we need to go for in situ and ex situ conservation. And in the country, we have gotten many protected areas and ex situ or in situ conservation sites, parks and arboretum. So we need to protect through suitable gene banks, species bank, and protected areas, and strengthen access and benefit sharing systems and mechanisms with the local people, these NBA, National Biodiversity Authority, and state biodiversity boards of every state. And these two constitute, these state biodiversity boards constitute biodiversity management committee at local level, at three local level, like municipalities.
I think Dr. M, we'll stop here. you so much for a very, very comprehensive, elaborate,
excellent
presentation.
Thank you. And
everybody like agrees that it's you've given a very, very complete.
All right. I understand. I'll stop here.
I'm really sorry because I have to leave. So
we need to.
Thank you so much.
We need to be sensible and we need to help to manage our resources. That's all. Thank
you. Yes, sir. बताइए sir.
चूंकि स्क्रीन शेयर भी नहीं हो पाया मैं 2-3 मिनट में मैं अपनी बात करूं.
हाँ सर प्लीज आप वो जो गिलोय का आपका पार्ट है गिलोय एंड करोना इफ यू कैन लाइक इलेबरेट इन 3-5 मिनट्स विल बी ग्रेट इट विल बी ग्रेट प्लीज गो अहेड आप बता दीजिए सर गिलोय एंड करोना एंड योर रिसर्च डॉक्टर कौशल कुमार आर यू हियर कैन यू हियर अस हेलो ओके बिफोर वी लाइक आर वी गो अहेड देर इज अ क्वेश्चन फॉर डॉक्टर साहा देर इज अ क्वेश्चन
यस यस
या सो देर इज अ क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम इंदु भंडारी सिन्हा सो शी सेड दैट व्हाट अकॉर्डिंग should be some simple grassroots level sustainable activities which should be undertaken by villagers of Uttarakhand because since you were like coordinating so many initiatives on behalf of CPCB and now you are with ministry so I think you are the best person to answer this yes
hello madam ji main abhi tak par rahi meri awaaz sunai pad rahi hai
हाँ अभी आवाज आ रही है सर आपकी ठीक है
बस मुझे ये कहना है कि जो गिलोय है गिलोय आप अपने घरों में लगाइए दिस इज माय रिक्वेस्ट दैट इट इज द वन ऑफ द मोस्ट इम्पोर्टेंट मेडिसिनल प्लांट एंड गिलोय द स्टेम यील्ड्स गिलोय सत्वा इट इज ऑलरेडी डॉक्यूमेंटेड और मे ऑलरेडी declared by the our Sangeeta Grantha, Ayurveda and also utilized in the folklore that you know Spora cordifolia which is the giloy is a very good immunomodulator it is antipyretic it is used for the diabetic patient and in the case of corona problem it may be utilized with the ashwagandha tulsi and recently Patanjali Yogpeeth has also formulated this formulation and from the Rashtriya Krishi Vikas Yojana in our research program from the Birsa Agriculture University and from the ICR All India Coordinated Research Project on Medicinal Plant we are carrying this great job for providing to everybody related to the planting material of the giloy it is because it is the one of the important and potential medicinal plant in of India which may fight against the coronavirus problem it not only promote our body is a good enhancer also or promote the immunity and protect from the infections also and related to the if somebody is suffering they have to take the vasa hydrocarbon clinica which I prepared for slide so but it could not possible so this preparation we may take a cut of piece of 2 gram or 3 gram for the utilization and we have a lot of experience related to this giloy is one of the most important plant and there are
hello I think Dr. Sahab, we can if I would request you to answer that question. Dr. Sahab? Dr. Yeah,
question me one second, please. What was that question? What was that question?
what sustainable initiatives the Uttarakhand people, they can take up? That is their question. Grassroots.
Okay. Just any area, defined area, just consider that the land, the soil, the plant, the people, the vegetation, the water, all are constant. And the culture, the tradition, these are really, sometimes these are also constant. And those are applicable for a particular purpose and particular issues to resolve to the thing. And these are locally generated. I would like to suggest this, cultivate those things in such a way so that the greeneries prosper. Prosperity of greenery will bring the economics. Once the economics comes, they'll be able to, the society will be able to sustain. They'll be able to grow. Let us not depend on exploitation, but depend on regeneration. This is the concept I would like to focus. No dependency on the exploitation, but rejuvenate, then use. That should be the concept at the local level. Because some of the plants grows very fast in some land area. Some of the fishes can go in some river. What is that particular species? What is that particular plant? What is that particular fruit? What is that particular vegetable? That we have to find out and grow accordingly so that it is economically beneficial and it is acceptable to the nature. That the few, the traditional people are already aware of it. Only they have to discuss and go with the system. The gentleman or the madam asked the question, are you happy with my answer or you have any?
सर द आंसर इज फाइन. एक्चुअली वो एक वही के उनका क्वेश्चन था मैडम का, तो इट्स परफेक्टली फाइन सर. थैंक यू सो मच. एंड नाउ आई वुड लाइक टू इनवाइट मिस्टर, आई वुड लाइक टू नाउ इनवाइट मिस्टर कल्पेश शुक्ला. एंड ही इज आर ईसी मेंबर एंड ही इज ऑल्सो कोऑर्डिनेटिंग आर सिटी चैप्टर्स अक्रॉस द कंट्री. ही इज द नेशनल कोऑर्डिनेटर. सो मिस्टर कल्पेश शुक्ला विल टॉक मोर अबाउट द एक्टिविटीज दैट द चैप्टर्स विल बी अंडरटेकिंग. सो ओवर टू मिस्टर कल्पेश शुक्ला.
हेलो, गुड इवनिंग एवरी वन. आई थिंक वी हैड अ वेरी वंडरफुल एनलाइटनिंग सेशन एंड आई बिलीव इट वॉज सपोज टू बी अ टास्क टू प्रोवाइड कंक्लूडिंग रिमार्क्स. But when I heard this expert, I realized that possibly I have very little to add to what they have said. But having said this, I would like to make a couple of observations. One is, it's a very heartening feeling to know that we have started very high in terms of richness of biodiversity that we enjoy. As a country, I think we are very lucky. We are very fortunate to have the kind of resources that are bestowed upon us. And therefore, we enjoy not just the geographic or topographical advantages, but we also have the kind of richness in flora, fauna, animal species, etc. However, having started very high also doesn't give us a very nice feeling, because we are likely to go downhill unless we really go about taking proactive action before it is too late. And that's where I understand the message from all the experts is, I think we need to balance the ecological biodiversity preservation versus economic growth and requirement of economic growth. And it cannot be one at the cost of another. And therefore, a very judicious balance is required. I think they have given very interesting suggestions besides exposing us to challenges that we face as community. However, as Ravi said, as a culture, we Indians have enormous respect for nature and we worship all our rivers and mountains. And I may not go to the extent of marrying a people or a banyan tree, but we certainly have very high level of respect for our ecosystem. We coexist with all the species and we try our best to ensure that we respect all the species. Now, having said this, concluding suggestion I may possibly have is in terms of taking judicious action, taking proactive action. We have experts and they introduce some very interesting concept of para experts. I think as we have paramedical staff, we need to probably have para experts, involve the stakeholders who are interested, who would be interested, because this ecosystem survives millions of people, not exactly within the premises of those biodiversity regions, but also downstream. And therefore, generating that interest and reviving their interest in preserving this, not at the cost of their own economic development of the region, I think we would be well placed to do a very good job of preserving this rich heritage that we have. I'm sure the experts would be available to people who are participating in this webinar. If they have any specific queries, I'm sure we would be happy to get the responses from the experts. So, Varin, I'm very happy that this very live, hot topic has been taken up for discussion by IITD Alumni Association. And I must thank Dr. Gitanjali for taking this initiative forward. Even pulling people like me who are completely not really clued into what is biodiversity, but she has forced me to read a few papers before I could come and join, and therefore understand slightly more than what I had expected. So I wish to thank all the speakers on my personal behalf, and I hand over the session to Dr. Gitanjali back. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Shukla. Thank you so much for your nice remarks. And now I would request our Secretary IIT Delhi Alumni Association, Mrs. Jyotsna Chugh Bareja, to give the vote of thanks. Jyotsna ji.
Everyone, this was really nice. Yeah, hello, can you hear?
Yeah, hello. You are audible. Yeah, yeah.
This was really nice discussion, very deep and wide. And what are the challenges in the national level? Now, I would like to thank you, Mr. Dipankar Saha and Mr. Muthaya Muragunandan, for giving all this knowledge to us and all the participants over here. And Dr. Kaushal Kumar also for giving the knowledge about Giloy, about how it can cure this corona and other diseases. I'd heard from different people, but I'd never believed them. So it's a scientific proof, then it's good. And I would like to thank you, our president, for allowing us to organize such webinar. And Dr. Gitanjali Kaushik, who has taken all the effort to organize this thing. And Mr. Kalpen Shukla, for giving all this bigger knowledge about biodiversity and other things. So thank you, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Muthaya, and thank you, Dr. Saha, and thank you, Mr. Kaushal. Let's finish this now.
Yeah.
And over to Lee.
Yeah. So once again, a very warm welcome, and I thank you, everyone, for joining us. And we, as highlighted by the expert, surely we'll try our best to support the conservation efforts, particularly in the Uttarakhand region. And I'm very sure that my president, my secretary, the coordination national coordinator, and along with all the experts, Dr. Saha from CPC, MOAFC, Dr. Kumar from BAU, and Dr. Muthaya from the Soil Institute, we will try to take a few initiatives, and we are hoping to start by next month. We'll come up with few initiatives. So thank you so much once again for joining us. Thank you so much. We'll stop now. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye.